You've heard me mention the term base level quite a lot. So now is a good time to define what base level is. And it's a term that was introduced by Joseph Barrow in 1917. So the idea of Joseph Barrow was that you had this base level, which is a bit of a theoretical concept, that could rise and fall. And base level is an imaginary line above which, so if you have sediment above base level, they are eroded, and below which, so below base level, sediments can be accumulated. Now, what constitutes base level is sea level for the marine record, but also the wave base, so the base at which sediments are not being eroded and transported. So let's try to make this a little bit more concrete by introducing fundamental terminology for sequence stratigraphy. So here we have a cross-section of the Earth, not to scale, of course, very simplistic, but useful for our understanding of this terminology. And we have basement in orange, so that's if you want the mantle, but also the lithosphere or the oceanic basalts. On top of this, we have potentially sediments, and then we have water that represents the ocean. So the first thing to realize is that we can define the center of the Earth as a referential. A referential means everything will be referred to the center of the Earth for our terminology. Now, from the center of the Earth to the top of the basement, we effectively have tectonic subsidence. That means that if you have uplift or if you have subsidence, you change the position of the basement. So you can either create or destroy space in a given basin by tectonic motion. From the center of the Earth all the way to the top of the ocean is what is known as, or to sea level, is what is known as eustatic sea level, or more simply, eustacy. So eustacy is absolute sea level. It's sea level that changes at the same time, the same way on the planet. That's when you, for instance, melt ice caps or freeze water into ice caps, that impacts eustatic sea level. But really, in most cases, or in all cases, what you measure is known as relative sea level, because what you measure is the distance between basement, so below the sediments, all the way to the center, or to sea level. And this is not everywhere the same, because it depends on the local tectonic of your basin. So if you do a measurement in Australia and a measurement on the New Jersey margin, for instance, you will have different relative sea level, even if eustacy is the same by definition. And then we have the distance between the top of the basement and the top of the sediment. That's known as sediment thickness, or defined here as S. And finally, of course, the difference between the top of the sediment and the top of the water column, that's water depth. And it should be clear to you at this point that water depth depends on a lot of factors. It depends on relative sea level, it depends on sediment supply, and of course, it depends on tectonic. So this gives rise to a famous equation, famous but simple, which is known as the accommodation equation, or sediment accommodation equation. So the accommodation equation essentially states that the tectonic movement plus the eustatic sea level should be equal to the sediment thickness and water depth. So these things are intimately linked. That means that you can actually change relative sea level by changing, for instance, the tectonic subsidence, but also it means that you can feel accommodation by increasing sediment supply. So there's really, in sequence stratigraphy, a very important concept that sediment supply, eustacy, and tectonic motion all contrive to impact water depth and to impact the shift of the shoreline. So if water depths change, you go from deeper sediments to shallower sediments. And if you look at the equation, the accommodation equation, everything is defined in this equation. It's an important one to know. So now let's imagine that we have, for the moment, a base level rise or a sea level rise. What happens if sea level is rising? Well, if sea level rises, the facies will migrate towards the continent. So here we have a beach facies, shore face, open shelf. When sea level rises, all of these facies migrate towards the continent. And I've already introduced that term. This is known as a transgression. So we have a transgressive sea that results in what is known as a retrogradational stacking pattern. Now, retrogradational stacking pattern is a bit of a mouthful. What does it mean? It simply means that if you look at Walter's law and the succession of facies, that succession shifts landward. So you can very clearly see here that the beach facies, for instance, that you found much deeper in the basin in the older sediment, now is much higher on the continent in the younger sediments. Now, of course, you can also reverse that trend. So say that the rise in base level, the rise in sea level slows down, and or that sedimentation picks up and that you feel accommodation, then what you have is a regression, and the sediments are now showing a progradational stacking pattern. And by progradational stacking pattern, I mean that the sediments that represent shallower condition or environment of deposition now migrates toward the basin. And the line that separates the transgression to regression is known as the maximum flooding surface, or MFS. So we can see with this transgression, regression, and the maximum flooding surface that sequence stratigraphic units can be further divided into system tracts. On this diagram, you can clearly see the transgression regression. You can also clearly see in red that we have sequence boundaries. And if you have a sequence, one sequence, you can have within sequences system tracts that represent a significant shift in the direction of migration of those facies. So for instance, from transgression to regression.